All right. So one of the things that we talked about that was completely missing from the podcast, and you were talking about a little bit of the acting and a little bit of pro wrestling and how those kind of two worlds link up. Like, who do you feel like? Because I always consider there are like some great actors in WWE. There's some great thespians, I would say. People like a Sami Zayn or a Johnny Gargano or something like that. Like, who do you feel like, who is actually like grabbing your attention right now? And what, and I think you said you took acting classes too, or you're taking acting classes?
Yeah, I took one semester in the spring. It was called Intro to Acting. So I've always been very analytical watching any given match. Like, I remember Stone Cold once on a podcast, he was talking about, I guess, his match with The Rock at WrestleMania 17. And he was, I guess, probably watching along and going through his thought process as he worked in the ring. And somebody took the audio from the podcast and synced it with footage of the match.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, you were really in his head. So he's like, you know, and I took this clothesline and I rolled to the corner, and that's basically me telling The Rock, come over here and stomp me out in the corner or whatever. And so, like, I would really just try to look at, like, just people positioning themselves or whatever. Or, like, why did this guy sell, like, when he got kicked in the face? Why did he go down to a knee rather than fall on his back? Like, I like to really analyze and decipher things. Like, it's really intriguing to me. And with this acting class, like, really, like, we did some monologues, but the majority of the class was one, getting comfortable with each other on a physical level into uncomfortable lengths, and being able to communicate with each other without words. And like, that's basically what they do in wrestling. Like, I remember Samoa Joe on Cheap Heat once saying that it's a language you just learn. You just learn how to wrestle. Like, it's not like learning how to dribble a ball. It's learning how to speak to the person you're in the ring with. And like, I remember bringing this up last time in the Lost episode. One thing that intrigues me is, like, you remember the match with Cedric Alexander and Kota Ibushi from the Cruiserweight Classic?
Of course, a classic.
Like, I don't know if Kota Ibushi knows English, or at least years ago, or I don't know how fluent his English may be, you know?
He knows very little English.
Yeah, so to me, like, you know, you've got guys that plan things out. Like, I remember DDP once saying he liked to script his things from bell to bell. And, you know, some guys, or some matches rather, will have their high spots, you know, that you got to get to for storyline implications. And, you know, the finish is always, of course, a little scripted thing there.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, sometimes guys will generally call things in the ring, like, in between the high spots, you know?
Right.
But, like, a match like that between them, like a match of the year caliber type match, 20 minutes or whatever it was, like, it was just mind boggling to me, because, like, I'm sure Cedric doesn't know Japanese and Kota doesn't know English. So, like, how do they call that in the ring? Like, what's going on there? And so, like, in this acting class, like, I really learned how to speak to someone else using just your body, and how to really know them and know what they're going to do. And I keep referencing Cheap Heat. I mean, shout out to them.
Shout out to them, yeah.
I remember it might have been, like, not even an interview, really. Peter might have just called Finn Balor just on the spot for no reason and shot the shit with him. But I remember Finn Balor once saying one of his favorite guys to work with is Samoa Joe, because he just knows Joe in the ring better than he knows himself. Like, he knows what Joe's going to do before he knows how he'll react to it. And Peter might have said something like, okay, let's say it's a Raw TV match. 5 minutes in, you're sitting in the corner. What does Joe do? And Finn's like, oh, he's going to run and do a rolling whatever the hell into the corner. He's going to pick me up, slam me down, da-da-da. And I'm just like, I remember listening to that, like, how do you know what he's going to do? Like, y'all ain't married, or, like, you know, like, what's going on? Like, I just didn't understand that, like, you know, the one meme where people's brains are connected through electricity. Like,
yeah,
I'm like, I don't understand what Finn is saying here. But in this class, I understood it. You know, I was able to learn this nonverbal language with my classmates. Like, there was one exercise we did, like, maybe like five of us were in the center of the black box theater, I guess is what they call the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like five of us, and the professor is like, okay, the scenario is a hospital, go. And we immediately all have to snap into a role and do something with one another. So you know, like before he says go, I'm like looking at who I'm working with. Like, I'm like, I see Rob. I'm like, okay, Rob likes to be dramatic. So he's probably just going to start screaming. And I know Saudi, she's probably going to just drop to the floor and act dead.
Right.
Like, okay, I can work with this. So when the professor said go, that's exactly what happened. Saudi dropped to the floor. And so I'm like, okay, I'll pretend like I'm doing CPR. Like I knew what they were going to do before I knew what I should do. And
right.
So like, I really understood what Finn Balor was saying there. And all of that's just so intriguing to me. Just the science of pro wrestling and how a match works.
Yeah. And that's intriguing to me too, to see how someone approaches that from a different angle. Like obviously you're learning that in school. And, you know, a lot of people are learning that, you know, have been learning that since they were kids. I mean, like the visual and audio cues that people give, like, you know, we joke people that call spots loudly, but that's just another way of language. Just like the way that they speak. And, you know, seeing that from the other side and hearing people like Finn Balor talk about that, or hearing about stories in the ring that Stone Cold loves to talk about. He loves running matches down. And I like the most Austin podcast, like, when he'll talk about matches when he thinks the other person was thinking. And I love when he'll call right. matches like that, and he'll watch them live. Like, those are some of my favorite episodes, because to me, like, I love the psychology behind it. I love figuring out, well, why did booking do that? You know, I never look at a booking decision and say, okay, this is just the most terrible thing ever. And I think, like, Mills kind of, you do the same thing as well. It's like, we try and look at the psychological, you know, and the kind of like the long-term effects of this. Like, what does this mean for the crowd? What does this mean for the performer? What does this mean for the audience? And you have so many masters that you speak to within pro wrestling, the same that you do as an actor. I mean, you see movies now like Joker and all these other movies right now that are being like, kind of like, what is this going to do to society? But, you know, essentially it's all communication. All of it is communication, socioeconomic, sociopolitical, all of that goes within it. And I think, you know, none other than like pro wrestling, like nothing other than pro wrestling, like really brings all of those together, like the good and the bad, the salacious and non-salacious, the innocent and the non-innocent. Like we literally watch a platform that is broadcast from TVPG, TV14, sometimes, you know, unrated, and we all get something different out of it. But the one thing that stays solid is the communication. There will always be a bad guy. There will always be a good guy.